Okay, we will continue with our discussion on switched reluctance motor. So, last lecture, if we recap, we found that switching has to be done at an instant when the current, when the inductance is just rising, and it has to be disconnected as the inductance is falling. Okay. So, a good design of a SRM system will have to take into account, one is inductance variation, that is depend upon the geometry of the machine. Then it has to take into account how the rotor position is sensed. Now, you must have proper sensors to sense the rotor position. Then you must have an appropriate controller to see that the appropriate windings are switched to the voltage source. Here the voltage source is a DC source. Okay. DC must be obtained through a rectifier, but you will be able to pass a current. And we also know that it is not possible to pass a rectangular current while you can apply a rectangular voltage. So, when you apply a rectangular voltage from a DC source, current builds up in the windings, and current build up is decided by the circuit equation. And you have a simple circuit, you have one winding having its own resistance, you are applying a voltage. So, V will be V equal to R I plus d lambda by dt, where lambda is L I, L is a function of theta and I. Okay. Therefore, we have to estimate the current. So, current is generally at low speeds, you have a chopped currents, which is almost approximate to a rectangle, but high speeds it is normally a pulsed current. One pulse, it goes like a current builds up and comes down. Now, in the circuit there will be freewheeling in such a way that the current will, even after the device is switched off, the current will continue to flow because there will be some flux in the winding. But current may go to zero by appropriate control system. So, these are all the issues of operation, and you should also know for what purpose you are using SRM. It is not just for academic research, it is for the purpose of driving a load, right. It could be a compressor load or a fan load or a machine tool load or robots or whatever. And you have to see whether it is a variable torque or a variable speed, or a constant torque or a variable speed, or a constant speed or a variable torque. So, this is all the requirement. So, accordingly your controller must be designed. Okay. Now let us look at how these controllers are used, what type of controllers are used, and how they are being made effective. Okay. Now, we have found out that critical issue is to know the inductance profile. How do you find the inductance? Well, this has been one of the areas. How do you find the inductance of the winding? I mean, it may look obvious. How do you find inductance of the winding? If you are given a coil, what do you do? You pass AC current and pass a voltage, okay, and pass a current and find the impedance and reduce the resistance and find the reactance and divide by omega, you do it. And now you do it for different omega, you may not get the same L. If you apply to different voltage, you may not get the same L, and if you pass a different current, you may not get the same L, because you know the whole your inductance is unfortunately a non-linear device because of the core, which is a which gives you different flux at different currents, and flux by current is not same. Okay. Therefore, it is a little involved process of finding an inductance, because unfortunately inductance is what decides the performance. Okay. Therefore, you can think of you know, coil impedance measurement, you know, inductance measurement. There are also LCR meters available, or you can have the AC bridge methods. Okay. Okay. Now, these are what you normally do if you are given inductance. Okay. There are bridges are there, AC bridges, but these are not suitable for SRM due to its highly nonlinear circuit, okay, and non-uniform air gap. Because inductance you have to measure at different positions. Okay. In fact, once you used to give an experiment to our students on one of the SRMs just to find the inductance at different rotor position. Okay. How it changes is very important. Okay. So, we will like to see. So, typically there are 5 methods for measurement of inductance of the SRMs. One is the static inductance measurements, and another is high frequency superposition method. You put DC and over you put AC, then flux linkage method, and then you can also calculate by design methods. Another is a frequency response method. Okay, let us look at what it means. Okay. Now, static inductance measurements is, you know, you calculate the rate of rise or fall of current in a series RL circuit. Okay. Now, V equal to R I plus L d I by d t. Therefore, V minus R I divided by d I by d t will be L, is not it? Nowadays, I think in fact, if you have this lab view etcetera, maybe this may be an interesting experiment. So, you can measure the voltage and current waveform or a response and find out inductance, right. Then we had a process. That means, for rising current L will be R into T over logarithm of I over I minus small I. For falling current, by using L equal to T R over logarithm of I by I. So, you take a log of that. Okay. So, you have a expression for rising current or falling current, what is the value of inductance. Okay. So, what you need? You need a digital storage oscilloscope, recording of current, downloading of data on PC, and data processing the acquired bulk of digital data for inductance estimation. So, this is a little old, I am only thinking now loud. Now, you have this virtual instrumentation and lab view. Okay. Can we not sense the voltage and current over a sample period, then process it and get the inductance? Okay. As apply a voltage V, okay, and find the response I, right, and try to get the inductance. Okay. Will you try this? Right. You have the lab view. And lab view does all the processing. Okay. And I think when these proposals were there, maybe such online data processing systems were not available. Now, perhaps you can do it. Okay. Now, there is a high frequency superposition method. Here, you know, L is obtained by this known expression. Okay. That is XL equal to Z square minus R square square root. So, excite the stator winding by DC source up to rated current. Then superpose high frequency AC along with DC excitation. So, you have to have a system applying a AC superposed over a DC. Okay. So, you require true RMS meters. This is one other thing. You require both DC and AC excitation. And you require coupling capacitors to prevent interaction of AC and DC source. Okay. So, this is one of the methods. Of course, some of them are published in literature, maybe you can go through this. Okay. Then another one is the flux linkage method, third method. So, that means you calculate the flux linkage. Okay. How do you find the flux linkage? Integral of V minus R I d t, is not it? That is the flux linkage. So, you can find the flux linkage. So, direct sensing of flux by flux meters, but nowadays integrated in the motor assembly, okay. Indirect measurement of flux linkage, of course, I mean there are methods of flux meters, maybe it is little clumsy. Perhaps you can measure the voltage signal and the current signal, find V minus Ri, integrate and get the flux as a function of time. Then when you know the flux linkage divide by the current, it should give you the inductance, is not it? Okay. I say this might be interesting. You have SRMs in the lab, maybe you can try with different positions and see how it works. Okay. So, what it requires is a software to do integration or hardware integration. Which one do you prefer? Nowadays you can think of software integration, you can program it by using the current and voltage signals, okay. You need a proper data acquisition. So, you require a ripple free DC source. So, what you say is, but your DC source must be ripple free. If this has ripple, it will create another problem. Okay. You require a battery preferably. What you do is take a battery, close the switch and measure the current, okay, and how, what will be the inductance, and again it will depend upon the rotor position. So, you require high speed data acquisition system with proper synchronizing of data and closing instant of recording. Okay. It must be properly done, you know, voltage current sensing must be very accurate. There should not be any delay, your sensors must not create errors in your measurements. Of course, you require PC interface and proper filtering of acquired data, use of curve fitting techniques, and inductance is obtained by differentiating flux linkage as a function of current. So, inductance will be d lambda by di. Okay. You may have lambda by, you can find out this one also. I mean, though these concepts appear to be trivial, but when you actually conduct experiments, you get into a lot of mess. So, in fact, engineers have to get into the mess to understand what are the practical problems involved. Okay. Now, another method is a design based method. If you are given a total design tools, I mean design data of the machine in terms of number of turns, the geometry, the pole geometry, the stator pole, rotor pole geometry, air gap geometry, etcetera, then you can simulate the whole thing on a FEM software, finite element software. Okay. So, using the design data, that means stamping data, winding details, length and characteristics of the machine, of the materials. So, you have FE, generate, you know, finite element mesh, use any of these methods and obtain the flux plots. Okay. So, for different position you obtain the flux plots, you find out what is the flux linkage. Estimate inductance in post processing package of the software. There is a post processing factor in some of the software. So, this is one of the methods one can use, right. So, what you require here is high speed computers with large memory and expertise in FEM software. Well, nowadays they have been made pretty user friendly. So, there's many softwares are there on finite element methods. Okay. Experimentally, you can do the frequency response method, right. That means, you can have a variable frequency source. So, you do it at different frequencies, okay, and you can find out the resistance and inductance. One important thing is when you are putting a variable frequency, then there is also a core loss component. And people may ignore it. There is core loss. So, you have to subtract the core loss also into your measurements. So, if you have you need to have a proper power analyzer, you have variable frequency source, then do the measurement here, okay, on this winding. Find the impedance, and impedance will have to be, it will have its own core loss component here. So, it will have winding resistance, it will have inductance and core loss component. So, you need to estimate this. The core loss will depend upon the frequency also. Okay. Therefore, you have so this is the method to calculate the inductance. I think this is very simple. These are the standard equations of AC circuits that you are aware of. Okay. You measure power, voltage, core loss, core loss resistance, then Y, and you can have G plus JB, then you find inductance, reactance and inductance. Okay. So, we have, I have just glanced through, it looks trivial, but you, when you conduct experiments, you will know what are the issues involved. Okay. Now, the other aspect we have to see, what type of controllers are actually used, practical controllers, okay, for switching the currents. Okay. So, the points are, you see, in other machines you look, you have a distributed windings. So, energy conversion SRM is due to discrete cycles through the interaction of one stator and one rotor pole pair. So, at any instant there is only one rotor stator winding and concerned rotor pole pair are interacting to produce the torque. So, torque is independent of the direction of phase current. You pass a positive current, negative current does not matter. So, it is I square. Okay. Therefore, which can be unidirectional. Okay. So, this permits the use of unipolar controller circuit, which has the advantage of reduced hysteresis loss. Okay. You can have unipolar controller circuits. Now, this is one, two transistor per phase. Okay. You have one transistor here, this is a DC source, okay, and these are three coils. Okay. So, you will have to energize at different instants of time. So, the transistor switching will be decided by the rotor position. Okay. So, you will see that, you know, these transistors switch, the current will flow through, okay, and when it switched off, then there is a freewheeling, okay, through this. These are two freewheeling diodes, one across this, one across this transistor. Okay. So, the winding is in series with both switches, okay, and then it provides a good protection against faults. Okay. Now, AC inverter versus SRM controller, see the other option, you know, in AC drives you have AC inverter, is not it? In if you have induction motor, your AC inverter. Now, upper and lower phase leg switches must be prevented from switching on simultaneously and shorting the DC supply, which is unnecessary in the SRM controller. And what is this term called? Shorting the DC supply. This is a fault, shoot through fault. So, there you see, that means we must take care, you know, AC inductor, AC inverter, that is the problem. Here there is, that is one of the advantages which is claimed here. Okay. Now, the how do you switch the procedure, switching procedure is upper and lower phase leg switches are switched on together, right, unlike in a inverter where it is only one top or bottom is open. Okay. At the start of each conducting period of working stroke, okay, now it is called a working stroke. Okay. So, if whenever you want to apply a voltage to the coil, you switch both of the transistors. Okay. At the commutation point, they are both switched off. If you want to, so you switch it off, okay, both of them, okay, and that is the normal procedure. Okay. Now, this is you know, one of the animation. Okay. This is the winding. Okay. Now, defluxing is to kill the flux. Okay. Fluxing is when it is passing the current, okay. Then there is this inert, nothing is happening. This is fluxing, freewheeling, defluxing, and inert. Okay. Inert is dead. Okay. So, you will see that see here it is defluxing is you are passing a current in the opposite direction, right. And fluxing is you are passing current. Okay. Okay, this is right. So, the current is flowing through like this, and this is the, let us see, the freewheeling. Freewheeling is only here. Okay. Current is going through like this. Is it okay? So, this is the process. So, there are four modes of operation: freewheeling, defluxing, inert, and fluxing. Okay. So, this is how the, that means only this, in this coil by these two transistors and two freewheeling diodes, the operation can be done. So, the current will flow through this in the normal mode as well as freewheeling, and then it can be, it may try to put opposite just to do the defluxing. Okay. Okay. Yes.
Same direction. Defluxing
also in the coil. In the defluxing, current may be flowing, but current. No, but voltage may be applied for negative. No, defluxing means just current may be flowing, but voltage may be negative. Just check what is the voltage across it. That's, see, the point is, your idea is, you know, in normally current will build up, okay, then it will freewheel, then you want to, you know, if you just allow it to go, it will take a long time, but you want the current to come to zero as early as possible, okay, right? Maybe I'll make it available so you can go on seeing as long as you want, okay, and convince yourself it does the job. Okay. Now, during the conduction period, either or both of them may be chopped. Now the thing is, during the conduction period, they may be chopped according to some control strategy. Then chopping can also be done. Okay. So, what chopping means, you can just do the transistor firing in the chopping mode, okay, and such as maintain the current within the hysteresis band. You can always say, as when the current goes, you can switch off it, okay. Now, the pulse width modulation mode of operation is necessary. You can also do PWM mode of operation at low speeds. As we said, you know, at high speed is a single pulse, at low speed is a PWM. To avoid high currents, as the self EMF of the motor is much smaller than the supply voltage, okay, because you cannot allow a very high current to flow through. At high speeds, both transistors remain on throughout the conduction period. So, you do not do much chopping, you know, on off mode is not there, and the current waveform adopts a natural shape depending upon the speed and torque. So, it is more a simple pulse which takes place, okay. Now, at the end of the conduction period, okay, when both switches are turned off, because then there is a magnetic stored energy in the coil. Magnetic stored energy that has not been converted into mechanical work is returned to the supply by the freewheeling. Okay. So, there is a freewheeling, but both transistors are off, but diodes are on. Okay. Now the thing is, if you want to do an analysis of this, you must write the appropriate equations. Okay. So, there will be one equation of free driving, one equation of conducting, etc. So, inductance varies with rotor position. Therefore, if fixed frequency chopping is used, the current ripple varies. Okay. If hysteresis type current regulation is used, okay, the chopping frequency varies as the pole approaches alignment. Right. I mean, these are some statements we need to know about the controller. So, chopping frequencies about 10 kilohertz are usually desirable to minimize acoustics noise. Right? Your idea is, you would like to reduce the acoustics noise, therefore, you need to have a high frequency chopping. So, it becomes more like a rectangular pulse, right. Now, there is another type of control, N plus 1 transistors converter for N phase motors. That means, if you have a 3 phase motor, use 4 transistors, and okay, right, 4 phase motors you can use 5 transistors. Okay. So, in small drives, it is often acceptable to use PWM control over the entire speed range. Okay. In such cases, the SR control circuit can be reduced to the to this figure. Okay. So, that means, you have 3 phases, you have 4 transistors. Okay. Here, okay, and then there is only freewheeling diode plus this. So, this transistors will be coming for all the 3 windings, okay. So, this can be sharing with all the windings in a way, okay. So, the operation is as follows. The lower transistors commutate the charged voltage to the phases in proper sequence, okay, under the control of shaft position sensor and gating logic. So, its lower transistors will do this, and that means this circuit requires n plus 1 transistors and n plus 1 diodes for a motor with n phases. Okay. Now, a bifilar winding, that means one winding is split into two parts, like a, almost like a center tap, you know, and one portion, if you want to do forward rotation, use one set, backward rotation, use the other set. Okay. So, that is why it is called a bifilar winding. So, you have say phase 1 have 2 segments, phase 2 has 2 segments, phase 3 has 2 segments. Okay. So, and they are, you can say, you know, coupled in the opposite direction, right. So, if this voltage is up, this is the voltage down like that. Okay. So, you can, this is one of the systems which are used, but these bifilar windings are wound on the same poles, okay, and center tapped. So, the bifilar winding suffers from double the number of connections. You require more connections because you have split into, it is not 2 terminals, you have 4 terminals. Okay. A poor utilization of copper and voltage spikes due to imperfect coupling between the bifilar winding. This is one of the problems. Okay. Then split link circuit used with even phase number. Okay. So, you have, these are 4 phases. This is another circuit. You have the voltage and you have these 2 transistors and 2 diodes which are used here. Okay. I think, you know, these are more like the theory. Okay. I will quickly go through this, and these are given in the books. I suggest you can, Miller's book gives a different circuits like this. So, split link circuit in the figure has been successfully used by, this is one of the task drives, one of the companies, with GTO transistors, thyristors in a range of about 4 to 80 kilowatt. Okay. This is another popular one, I was told, is C dump circuit. C dump circuit, you have a, this is a 3-phase, you have a transistor here, single, and you have another transistor, these are 3 transistors in this circuit. Okay. And let me see, we have, so here the device count is reduced to n plus 1 additional device, okay, to bleed the stored energy from the dump capacitors C bank to the supply via this step down chopper circuit. So, again it is another circuit, C dump circuit. Okay. So, here mean capacitor voltage is maintained well above the supply rail to permit rapid defluxing after commutation. A control failure in the energy recovery circuit would result in rapid buildup of charge in the dump capacitor. So, it has a basically a C dump means you are dumping in the capacitor, C is the capacitor. Okay. Right. And if protective measures were not taken, the entire converter could fail from over voltage, not from over voltage. Okay. Right. So, we have quickly gone through the different control circuits, and people are developing this. The whole idea is, as the device ratings increase, you can develop different circuits, and more software and less hardware seems to be the future. So, we have completed this, we will stop it here. Okay, and next class we will take up stepper motors as well as other aspects of SRM. Okay. We will close it here today. Thank you.